Hi everybody, my name is Nicola Morizzi, I'm a cardiologist working in Lausanne University Hospital in Switzerland and with a passion for cardiomyopathies. I'd like to welcome you to the fourth HCM Pills episode, and I'm very happy of introducing today one of the members of our scientific committee, Professor Jolanda van Velden. We are here in Amsterdam. She's a true expert in understanding the pathophysiology, that is to say the reason why disease developed in relation to cardiomyopathies and specifically to HCM. I'd like you to remind that this series of webcasts, the HCM Pills, are sponsored by the European HCM Patient Foundation, a non-profit organization that aims to bring at the European level knowledge for patients with the HCM. So Jolanda, let's go to the heart of the problem. So how is a heart of a patient with HCM somehow different with respect to other people's heart?
Yeah, other people's heart, well, for one, it's much bigger. Hypertrophy means that it's enlarged, it's bigger. And when you think about bigger, you often think like, you know, if that it's stronger, but that's not the case because it's actually not stronger in a sense that it's a diseased heart, right? So if you compare it to an increase in muscle, normally you would think, ah, that's good. But actually, it's not the case for people with HCM.
Okay, great. So we have a thicker heart, thicker. So are there any factors in the environment that really makes this heart looks thick and becomes thick?
Yeah, so there's quite a lot of research into that. And we know that in approximately 50% of the HCM patients, it's really a gene defect, so a DNA error, which is causing the increase in muscle mass. While in the other half of people, there's no direct single DNA defect found. And that's like most likely it's maybe a mix of changes in the background of the DNA, which makes people more vulnerable to get a thicker heart. But also we know that obesity is causing also, or is an additional trigger. So people should really take their steps during the day or bike if you're living in the Netherlands.
But that's, yeah, of course. Yeah. Okay, big heart, thick. What's the problem? Is it in how it uses the energy and its fuel?
Yeah, that's a good point, actually, because that's where a lot of the research focused on during the past years. It's really that we know that the sarcomeres, who are the motors in the single heart muscle cells, that they generate the force. So they take care for the heart to pump out the blood to the body. But they need energy. We call that ATP. It's a molecule. And we also know that the hearts of people with HCM use much more energy to be able to pump the blood to the body. And that's probably a starting point for a lot of problems they encounter. So I always compare it with an expensive car. You know, you need much more gasoline to drive a certain distance compared to a cheap, more economic car. So it's,
I find it's a very important example also because for your life expectancy, probably you don't need an expensive car or Maserati, but you need somehow more a truck, something that is working for the years to come effectively and uses an efficient amount of energy. Going into this detail that is very, very important, so, you know, and an energy problem. So how is it important really to do what you do in your daily life, that is to say, understanding the real key problem into a disease, to then design treatment?
The design of treatment, so that we should and is currently really looking at improving energetics of the heart muscle, because that's really a factor. We also know that people who do not have the disease and who do have the DNA defect, they already show a very high level of energy consumption. If you really do imaging of the heart, you see high energy consumption. So the medications that are really developed and already in place now, the first novel drugs are introduced, like the myosin inhibitors, really target that energy deficiency or the high energy demand.
Can we try to explain to our audience how this efficient use of energy is done by myosin inhibitor?
Yeah, that's so I'll try to visualize it. It's always difficult, but if you think about the myosins and how they make sure that the heart produces force, they sort of walk over the one of the other filaments, we call it, and so you make a distance and you produce force, and with every step you could say they consume energy. And the myosin inhibitors basically, well, they improve the way you make the step, and then there's less energy consumption. Yeah. So it's a bit again compared to the car. Like you move from a really expensive car to this truck.
That's very important. It's very also simple to understand. So it's somehow an overambitious project, the HCM heart, that is moving to something that is more feasible for a lifetime somehow with myosin inhibitor. So are there any other drugs that try to target an efficient use of energy, or?
Yeah, it's more, so we know that the very first, or some first studies looked at the substrates which are used by the heart. So a normal heart uses a lot of fats and also glucose. And so there's also medications which try to shift from the fatty acid, or from the fat to the glucose, and that might end up in more energy for the heart muscle. So it's really like a diet change for the heart with a medication. So there are some studies which show that that might also have a positive effect. Although if you compare it to the myosin inhibitors, the effect is less clear and less consistent in the different studies.
But still another point is, you know, that you're making, that is extremely important, understanding the why a disease is developing. So the very first problem is key in to prevent disease complication and prevent disease. Do you think in the near future we'll arrive somehow with an early administration of myosin inhibitors somehow to prevent the disease? Do you have any experience in animal models in doing that?
Yeah, well, it has been shown in animal models that it can do. And of course, that's the ultimate goal, right? Of all research, that you do, want to prevent disease in people who carry a DNA defect. And steps are being taken. I think what we need to do is know per individual what's the real problem, to give the right medication to a specific patient, but also at the right time. So that's always like, when do you start treating people who do not have a disease, but maybe sort of subclinical already a drug?
There's a lot of unanswered points, so a lot of work to do still. And this brings me also to my last question. So what do you think are the future steps in your basic research and how these potentially can impact patients' life?
Yeah, so what we now move towards is the stem cell research. So that's advancing quickly. It's still really expensive research because it takes a long time. So ideally you would be able to make heart cells from stem cells which are isolated from the blood of an individual, and then you could actually see, test different drugs and see which is the most ideal drug for an individual. That's still far away, but it's already well, that's at least what we focus on in our research, to try to optimize these models and see if we can really move towards a precision medicine, we call it, like, really based on genetics, give a certain drug. So that's the future. We have other mechanisms now which we are focusing on. We know that the cytoskeleton, the microtubules, is altered of heart muscle cells. So that's another sort of area which we are exploring and which may also be targeted in the future. That's very early phase, but who knows? Yeah.
That's all very exciting. Yeah. Very, very, very exciting. So I thank you very much for being here. And I'd like to thank you as well to have watched this fourth episode of HCM Pills. I do remember to subscribe to our channels and to comment, to have other questions that can be important for you being asked to our next experts. And thank you very much.